We'd like to welcome on stage Aakanksha Gulati. And before she comes on stage, let me quickly introduce herself. Introduce her. Aakanksha is currently working with Teach for India, which is a non-profit organization that aims to bridge the academic achievement gap in India through their fellowship program. She has over 8 years of work experience, and she has also been a consultant for strategy planning for one of the largest global children's development NGOs. Prior to working for Boston Consulting, she worked with Keith, Brockwood and Woods as an assistant vice president that was managing the loan portfolio strategies. And before joining Teach for India, she was working with Markshares, an educational technology startup. And currently, she is the city director of Delhi, and she is a part of Teach for India's senior leadership team. So we would love to welcome you on stage, Ms. Aakanksha, and hear a few words of wisdom from you. Let me have a loud round of applause.
Today is my first introduction to Toastmasters, and what an incredible group of people you guys are. And so many of the values that I've heard being talked about today resonate so deeply with the values of our organization. And I'm going to share a little bit more about that in just a few minutes. But before I begin, can I request everyone to stand up? Okay. And now that we are standing up, can I request everyone to come forward and fill up all these rows of seats that are empty? Yeah? I'm going to build on my last speaker's words of wisdom. Leaders are on time, and leaders sit in front rows, and leaders participate. So can I just request everyone to come so that we're a nice, tight, warm group sitting together, yeah? So please come forward. Let's fill up all these seats. Okay, we'll take just 5 more seconds to quickly settle down. Thank you so much. I know this is a tough session. We've just had lunch, and so I know the energy sort of seeps down, but we'll try to get it back up, yeah? And in a few seconds, I'll actually come down and I'll interact with all of you a little bit more deeply. Okay, thank you so much. Before I get into my story, and again, in the spirit of what Toastmasters is, which is you guys do a lot of public speaking, and as an organization, we also really, really believe in the power of sharing stories. So I'm going to do that with all of you today. I'm going to share my story. But before I do that, I'm going to ask each of you to actually think a little bit about your story before I begin. So I'm going to request everyone to close their eyes. Okay? Thank you. Close your eyes. All right. I want you guys to think about your dream career, okay? Your dream job, yeah? Keep your eyes closed. So go back, think about, you know, when you were a little child, what really used to excite you as you went through school, college? What did you imagine your dream career to look like, yeah? And so now, as an adult, if you had to go back through years and years of things that you've experienced and learned, today, what is your best understanding of what your dream career should look like, okay? And it can be something really specific. Some of you might know, you know, this is the exact company I want to work for in this position, building X. And for some of you, it might be a little bit more vague, which is also fine, yeah? So now just try to imagine yourself in this dream job or in this dream career. Okay, what does it look like? What does it feel like? What does it sound like? What does it smell like? What does your day look like? Just try to imagine yourself in that dream job or that dream career. Okay, keep your eyes closed. Now I'm going to ask you 2 questions. The first one, if you believe that everything you're doing in your life right now is leading you towards your dream job or your dream career, raise your hand, but still keep your eyes closed, okay? So that's category one. Category two is, if you believe that right now you're not doing everything, you're doing something else in your life right now, that working towards your dream career. So that's category 2. So if you're category 2, keep your hands down. But if you're category 1, keep your hands up. Okay? Alright. Keep your hands up. I'm going to ask everyone to open their eyes and just take a look around the audience. Okay? So about 20-25% of us raised our hands, which is fairly normal in almost any group that I've done this exercise in. It's about 20-25% of people who raise their hands, okay? And so with that, I'm going to share my story, okay? So my story goes something like this. And this is a story my parents share with a lot of pride. It's what I used to hear them tell other people as I was growing up. So I was a very bright child, always stood first in class, was extremely analytical, was very good with numbers, did very well in boards, and went abroad for my undergraduate to Duke University. So that is my graduation day picture. I majored in, I double majored in math and economics, and graduated with jobs to some of the best investment banks in the world. And I had four full-time job offers from investment banks on Wall Street. And I ended up joining Lehman Brothers. Now, for many of you, Lehman Brothers is an interesting bank. It's a bank that went bankrupt. And does anyone know what was the product that Lehman Brothers was trading that led to a huge economic crisis? Yeah, derivatives? Mortgages? Subprime loans? Okay. And so in 2007, this bright young child graduated from Duke University, double majors, magna cum laude, and my parents told everyone, she's going to Lehman Brothers and she is going to trade mortgage-backed securities. And so that was the beginning of my career. Obviously, a little over a year from then, Lehman did go bankrupt. I was lucky though, I did find a job immediately after Lehman Brothers, moved to Barclays, but continued working as a trader on Wall Street for 4 years in what I believe was one of the most challenging times in the financial industry and somehow survived. Post that, applied to business school, got into Kellogg as an Austin scholar, got my MBA degree, my 2-year MBA degree from Kellogg. Again, my parents shared this with a lot of pride. Interned at a consulting firm called BCG, the Boston Consulting Group, in their New York office, and graduated with a full-time job there. I also met my now husband at Kellogg, and shortly after that we decided we wanted to move back to India. We had been outside the country for a really long time, so took a transfer to the Delhi office of BCG. And so this is a story that many of you will see if you go to my LinkedIn profile, right? But actually what I want to share with you is version 2 of my story, which is the story that not my parents, but I narrate to people, okay? And that story goes a little bit like this. Ever since I was a really little child, I was obsessed with what used to happen at school. I was obsessed with the process of teaching. I was obsessed with the process of learning. I used to come back from school every day and reteach the same lessons that my teacher had taught me, okay? And just any guesses, like who do you think I would catch a hold of and teach to, right? My brothers and sisters, my parents, my neighbors' kids, who else? Maids' kids, yeah, all of that. But actually, 80% of the time, I would be teaching no one. I would be teaching an imaginary person, right? So my parents used to look at this little child, 7 years old, and wonder, what is she doing? But that was really me. I was obsessed. I would keep coming home and keep teaching and reteaching the same lessons because I felt that, how can we actually make the process of teaching and learning better? What can I learn if I reteach that lesson? And with a lot of pride, I used to say, when I grow up, I'm going to be a teacher. And at that young age, my parents used to say, yes, of course, you should be a teacher. And as I kept getting older, every time I used to say, I want to be a teacher, the responses became quite muted. And so by the time I was going off to college, they were like, teacher kaun banta hai beta, teacher nahi banna hai. And so I saw that their response had dramatically changed from when I was a little girl, as I was growing up. But it's something that never left me. And I realized that that's when I started living two parallel lives, right? So I was pursuing my math and economics degree by day, but in the evenings, every day in college, I was working with at-risk students, I was volunteering, I was teaching kids who had learning disabilities. Behind my parents' back, I also went and got a teaching degree. So it was a four-year college. I finished all my coursework in 3 years. While I was doing that, I also took all the teaching classes that were required to get a teaching certification. So curriculum design, pedagogy, child psychology, and then I spent my fourth year teaching full-time so that by the time I graduated, I would have a full-time teaching degree, right? And that's when this parallel journey started getting tough, because I had multiple opportunities in my life to actually jump to the field of education, and I didn't. So when I was graduating, I had teaching offers, but I also had offers from finance, and I didn't have the courage to tell my parents, hey, actually I want to be a teacher. I lived in New York for 4 years. I was a trader by day, and at night I used to run my own NGO. We were running a program where through a pen pal curriculum, we were trying to improve English literacy of kids in Delhi. I went to business school and again pursuing an MBA, but part of every education club, every incubator I could find. And even as I was graduating my business school, I again had an opportunity to work in the field of education, and I couldn't choose it. I took the path that was more known and familiar, and I went to consulting. And then finally I reached a point in my life where it became really difficult to lead these two parallel lives, right? Because in the beginning it was easy, they converged, but as I went through my career, it became tougher and tougher to do both. Because during the day, as I was working at BCG, I was getting more and more involved in the financial services practice, and it was getting really tough to keep up with what I believed was my dream career. And so that's when I hit an inflection point in my life, and I asked myself, why is it that I'm not working in education? I've been talking about it since I was 7 years old. And I thought about this a lot. I used to keep telling people, you know, I'm waiting for the right time, I'm waiting for the right place, and I'm just waiting for the right opportunity. And so when that right opportunity comes, that's when I'll quit BCG and I'll go and work in education. And I often wondered, but if I do start working in education, what will my parents think? And what will my friends say? And these questions were really tough for me to answer. And then finally, I don't know where, but out of nowhere, I did reach this deep, dark place in my life, and I was like, this is just getting really tough. And so then I asked myself, what does right time and right place and opportunity really mean? Is it just going to come to me, or do I need to do something about it? Do I need to actually find the courage to answer those questions that I'm so scared to answer? And so basically the next day, I got up and I told BCG, it's been an incredible experience, thank you so much, I've learned so much, but I have to quit today. Because I've been wanting to work in education for as far as I can remember, and actually I'm the only one who can go out there and find the right time and the right place and the right opportunity. And so thank you so much, but I have to leave. And that's basically, as arbitrary as that sounds, that is how my journey went from one track to the next. And it really was about me taking ownership of my career, me actually driving my career myself, and taking that huge leap of faith and saying, I'm going to figure out what it is that I want to do in education. And that really was the biggest inflection point in my life. And it sounds really arbitrary, because we often think, oh yeah, like, I'm going to do something and there'll be a series of steps and eventually I'll get there. And for me, as anticlimactic as it sounds, it wasn't. It was abrupt, it was an arbitrary decision, and it happened overnight. And basically, I then basically tried to figure out, okay, what is happening in the ed sector in India? I haven't lived here in 14 years. Let me figure that out. I started at a small edtech startup called Mark Sharks. And I realized once I finally made a move into the sector that I've been, what I truly believe, destined to work in, opportunities came out of nowhere. And then found my way to Teach for India, where I now head the Delhi site. So for those of you who don't know about Teach for India, we operate out of 7 cities. We are a very young organization. We only started 8 years ago in Mumbai and Pune. Delhi was the third city. Delhi's quickly grown into the largest TFI site. I now head a team of about 40 staff members and 300 fellows who are part of this two-year fellowship program where they teach in government schools, but more than teaching, we're a leadership development program. And so for the rest of the few minutes that I have with you guys, I'm also going to talk a little bit about what I've learned about leadership as I'm leading this really large team of almost 400 people. And what have I really learned about leadership from Teach for India, which claims to be a leadership development organization, very similar to what Toastmasters is. And so like I said, the first question I was asked, the prompt that I was given as a keynote speaker is, how did you navigate your career? And I tell people, it's these two words. You need to take ownership of your career. Your career is not something that your parents can drive for you. It's not something that your significant other can drive for you. Only you can drive your career. And I just feel like this notion that I had of waiting for the right time, right opportunity, just, it wasn't working for me. I had to really, when I mean drive my career, I had to be in the driving seat. And courage. And I just feel for someone like me who just always knew, I didn't have the courage to answer those tough questions, but ultimately it had to come from within. And so that's the first part, which is how you navigate your own career. And I believe it's these two. By no means do I believe this is the right answer for everyone, but this is just my story. And so what have I learned about leadership? And again, this will be contextual, so I'm going to speak about the work that I do at Teach for India. At Teach for India, I believe I'm solving a really wicked problem. We're trying to figure out how to get every child in the country the best education possible. And that's really, really, really difficult. And I'll tell you why it's difficult. So when I grew up in the Indian education system, I was told I was a really good student because I was good at math and science. And for many, many years in my life, I truly believed that's what being a good student means. It means being very analytical, being good with numbers. And I truly believe that was a good student. In grade 6, I moved to the United States. And suddenly I realized how not creative I was when it came to writing. I wasn't taught to read. I was not an avid reader. I didn't really enjoy subjects like history and geography and didn't really know about the world. And so for the first time in my life, I realized how analytical literature could be and writing a paper on text could be. I realized how important liberal arts were to actually develop me into a holistic student. I realized how important values and mindsets are and how important opportunities and traveling is to actually making me a global citizen. And so I came back to India then in 10th, where suddenly I was thrown into the board exams. And again, it made me question, what are we doing here, right? What is the system that we're in? Is this really an education that we're proud of? And I planted three questions in my mind that I continue to solve till this date, which is really, what is an excellent education? How do you define it? Is it just math and science? Is it all subjects? Is it something more than that? That was question number one. The second question I asked myself is, how do you deliver that excellent education in the best manner possible? Is teacher the only vehicle through which we can get an excellent education to students? And if that's true, then what are we doing with teachers in our country? Because if that's the most important vehicle to get to our kids, we need to invest a lot more in the teachers, right? Or does education play a role? Do parents play a role? Are these also important vehicles to get an excellent education to kids? And the third question I asked myself is, how do you do that for every single child possible? Because I was going to some of the best schools in the country, in India, in Delhi, and it made me really question, if this is the quality of education I'm getting, what is that child in the government school getting? What is that child who's not even in school getting? Because we're a country of 320 million children right now. That's a huge number. And so with these three questions, which I asked at a very young age of, 15, 16, they actually stayed with me and they've continued to form the foundation of what I continue to work towards. And I think any organization that I go into, it's really rooted in these three questions. And that's what we're trying to do at Teach for India. And so why is this a wicked problem? It's a wicked problem because we've realized a million things go into a child's education. It's actually not just what's happening in the classroom. It's what happens in early childhood. It's what happens with health, nutrition, sanitation. It's what happens when that child becomes an adolescent. It's what happens with parents, school management committees. There are a million things that go into a child's education. Out of it, Teach for India is just doing what happens inside classrooms. And so the reason it's a wicked problem is actually in this sector, we all need to be working together. Because unless all of these ingredients come together for a child, that child is not going to receive an excellent education, and that child is not going to be an incredible human being in this world. And so we really, really need to work together. Now, the sad truth that I've learned is everything that I was taught about leadership, whether it was in school, whether it was in various companies that I worked in, whether it was my MBA degree, it was about individual leadership. It was about how do I become a leader? And I realized actually to solve this wicked problem, we need to talk about collective leadership. It's about how do we as individual leaders interact with other leaders to get them to think about a common problem and work together. And so I think that's been a key learning in my leadership journey. We often talk about individual leadership, but actually that's not going to solve problems. I think about the air pollution problem in Delhi right now, and why is it it's not getting solved? Because the government alone can't solve it, the corporates alone can't solve it, the people alone can't solve it, but actually it's going to be all of us working together. But collective leadership is really, really tough. Because we don't know how to listen to each other, we don't know how to trust each other. It's very difficult, right? We also have personal agendas in the short term that must be met and must have momentum. And so oftentimes when you think about the collective, it means putting our personal missions and visions aside, and that's really, really tough to do. So I don't have answers, but just questions that I'm going to leave you guys with. The other things I tell people as a leader is that I fail every day. I tell people that many times I don't have answers. So 90% of the time when people ask me questions, I tell them I don't know. Okay? And almost every day I question my own knowledge. I question, wow, do I really know enough about the education sector? Why am I even working in this sector, right? And so when I tell people these three things, I tell them I fail every day, I don't have answers, and I question my own knowledge every day, they tell me, oh wow, like, you must be miserable. Like, do you feel like a failure? And I tell them, no. I feel successful in my work every single day. And the reason for that is I fundamentally have had to redefine what leadership really means. And that's happened for me after I've come into the work that I do now. And the reason I say failing every day is so important, because I think first and foremost, a leader is a learner, right? And I think when you're solving wicked problems, the reason it's a wicked problem is because no one in the world actually has an answer. So unless we have the orientation to fail every day and get really excited by the learnings that failure is going to give us, we can't move forward. And so one thing I push my team to do every day is, you want to try it out? Try it out. Fail and then tell me what you learned, because version 2.0 is going to be much better than version 1.0. Version 3.0 is going to be even better, and through this we're going to get closer and closer to the answer. Right? But the risk of not trying it is far greater. I also tell people the reason I don't have answers is because as a leader, I'm a facilitator. And alone, I can only come up with a good answer, but when I put together a group of really diverse people and perspectives, I know the answer is going to be multiple times better. And so actually, I don't want to have answers. As a leader, I don't want to tell my team what to do, because if I do that, I am not coming up with the most creative and the best answer that solution requires. And so I constantly tell people as a leader, I'm a facilitator, don't look at me for answers. But what I can do really well is I can get the right people in the room, I can ask the right questions, and I know that I can get you guys from good to great. Yeah. And third is, I think as a leader, I'm a researcher. And again, all wicked problems, the reason they are wicked problems is because we've just hit the tip of the iceberg, and there are many, many layers and nuances that we still need to discover. And so these are some things that I've learned about leadership. And then just to quickly summarize, what my journey over the last 10 years professionally, but really what I say since I was 7 years old, because that truly is when the seeds were planted in my mind for this work. But I think as you guys all think about your dream careers, my only advice would be one, please keep thinking about your dream careers. You only get one life, so don't let go of that. Take ownership, be courageous, yeah? And look to other people to give you that courage if it's not coming from within. But be on the lookout for that. And as you think about leadership, I really believe individual leadership is great. What does collective leadership really look like? And again, you guys have such a great forum because you guys belong to a group that's really invested in each other's learning, which is Toastmasters. So how do you really think about collective leadership? And how do you really think about personal transformation? Because unless you as a leader are growing and evolving every day, it's not going to flow down to the team that you're working with. And so this is just a picture of our staff team at Teach for India Delhi. I tell them that actually I get a lot of courage from them because it took me more than 30 years to actually get the courage and put my foot down and say, I'm getting up today and moving into the sphere of education. Some of these people had that courage at the age of 20, 21, 22, because even at that young age, they have the courage to tell their parents, you know, I don't want to be an engineer. I'm actually going to sign up for the Teach for India Fellowship. And they signed up to teach at some of the toughest schools in the country. So just a quick question again to the audience. Teach for India works in government schools. And I often ask people, who do you think are the kids who go to a government school in Delhi? Like, who are these kids? When would you have interacted with these kids?
The lower class, slum kids.
Maids, kids. Yeah. Drivers, kids. Yeah.
Basically, low-income group people.
Low-income group, yeah.
EPL group.
Yeah. So the truth is, actually, your maids' kids and your driver's kids are going to private schools. That is the reality of most of our cities. Most people who are able to even earn 10 to 15,000 a month are doing everything in their power to send their kids to private schools in our cities. And so the kids who go to government schools belong to a class much below that. These are kids you probably have not interacted with. These are families that are making less than 1 lakh rupees of income annually. And these are the contexts that these young people signed up to teach in, fighting just years and years of biases that have percolated down into the government schools. And so I tell them, you guys give me so much courage because what I learned at the age of 30 and more, you guys knew much earlier and you took that leap of faith. And so they continue to be my source of inspiration. This is just a quick picture of more than 300 fellows who teach in our government schools in Delhi. They sign up for 2 years and like I said, it's a leadership development program. And so what you guys get to do at Toastmasters, these guys get to practice that every day as they're building relationships with these kids, with parents, with teachers who are teachers in the government school context, the local grassroots level government bodies and leaders. And they get to practice what communication with a diverse group of stakeholders looks like. They get to practice what leadership in really tough contexts looks like. And then they graduate after 2 years and we tell them, you can go anywhere. So some of them go into the corporate sector. Some of them stay in the ed sector. We don't care what sector they're in as long as they continue to share stories, as long as they continue to be leaders, which I believe, again, is very similar to what Toastmasters is all about. And so if anyone's interested in also just learning more about this, I also have a staff member, Manath, who's in the audience, but she's here. She can speak to you guys more about Teach for India. But yeah, just wanted to share my story. We do have a deadline that's coming up in February, but yeah, just wanted to share my story and just leave really inspired because I think everything that I've learned about Toastmasters is so aligned to the values that we hold so dear. So thank you guys for having me.
And the standing ovation speaks for itself. Let's have another huge round of applause for Aakanksha.